If you're new with us, let me try to catch you up as to where we've been, okay? We are in a sermon series I've simply called God Revealed. And what we're doing in this sermon series that we kicked off in January was, the very first part of January, is we're trying to get a better understanding of who God is through what he says about himself in Scripture. And so far in this sermon series, we looked first of all at creation, that God reveals himself as creator through what has been made. And then as we look around and as we interact with creation, we get a very clear glimpse of who God is and what he's all about. And then we spent two weeks on the topic of that God is provider, that as you have needs, God has promised to meet and fulfill your needs. And I hope that those 2 weeks were not spent in vain. I hope that you grabbed hold of those truths, and that as you're going through life and it's hard and you have some needs, rest assured God has said he will take care of your needs. He is a provider. Now your wants aren't always guaranteed, they're not always promised, but God in his mercy and his grace provides for some of your wants as well. This week, and it's such an important and timely message, this week we're going to see God revealing himself to us as healer. And I know that that's a very timely message for a lot of us in here today. And what I want to do is I just simply want to begin our time together with some scripture. And this comes right out of the mouth of God, okay? As he's revealing himself, this is who God says he is, okay? Exodus chapter 15, verse 26 says, "And God said, if you will give earnest heed to the voice of the Lord your God and do what is right in his sight and give ear to his commandments and keep all of his statutes, I will put none of the diseases on you which I have put on the Egyptians." And then notice what he says, "For I, the Lord, am your healer." I know what a lot of you are thinking here this morning, especially if you're going through a tough time and you're dealing with some physical ailment that's in your life, or someone that you love is going through a physical ailment in their life. You're thinking, yeah, right. God may be other people's healer, but he's not my healer. I mean, I've been praying earnestly that God would step in and intervene and show himself strong in this situation, and that hasn't happened. And so, Mark, I really don't care to hear what you have to say about God being a healer, because quite frankly, he hasn't healed me or my loved one. And I know that that's a very real sentiment among some of you. And that's why I want to start off by praying here this morning. Let's pray. Father God, we turn to you now and we're studying your word, and we want to see you clearly revealed. We want to understand better about how you heal, Father. And I pray here this morning that there are those who are struggling with this truth. I pray, Father, that their circumstances, that their experiences would not define for them who you are. God, you don't change. You are the same yesterday, today, and forever. And I pray, Father, that though there's been some who faced heartache and disappointment, that we would lean heavily upon your word at this time, and that we would look to it as truth. And I just pray, Father, that you would show yourself as someone who is real, someone who cares. And Father, that those who are struggling with this idea might see you very clearly. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So today, as we get to know God, one of the things that he wants you to know about him is he's like, hey, I am your healer. Okay? And that's pretty important. And that's a pretty, if you study that phrase, I am your healer, there's some implications there. And this is where we need to start, okay? We must recognize, first and foremost, jot this down if you're a note taker, healing is necessary. Can we all agree with that? Healing is necessary. If there were no disease, if there was no sickness, if there was no ailment, then God wouldn't need to define himself as our healer. But the mere fact that God calls himself our healer, indicates that there is, in fact, a problem. And so let me ask you this morning, do you need healing? Maybe a better question to ask this morning is, what kind of healing do you need? Because as we're talking about healing, there's something that you probably know but never really gave much thought to, and so I want to define it for you. There's really two types of healing that are necessary. First and foremost, there is the physical healing that is needed, right? Flesh and blood needs to be healed. Just out of curiosity, I'm curious to know what kind of congregation we have here. Raise your hand if you've ever broken a bone. Okay, wow, there's a lot of you. Okay, put your hands down. Raise your hand if you've never broken a bone. That's me. I've never broken a bone. Okay, raise your hand if you, maybe we can't do that one because of HIPAA. Raise your hand if you should be on medication. Yeah, that's me. Raise your hand if you've ever been sick. If you've had that nasty sickness bug going around this year so far, have you gotten that? You've gotten, okay, stay away from those people, okay? You understand very clearly that our bodies are weak. They're amazing, the way that they're created. It's amazing how everything works. But let me tell you, because we live in a world that is fallen, our bodies don't always function the way that they should. They wear out with use. They get sick. They break down. And maybe you're here this morning and you suffer from chronic headaches or stomach pains or dizziness or fatigue. Then you know exactly what I mean. And throughout the course of this life, our bodies will suffer painful conditions, some serious painful conditions. Man, it seems like our church family has been hit hard with physical ailments. Cancer right now, it just seems to be a word that is all too common on our prayer list. And it's a frightening disease. And for those of you who've been recently diagnosed, you know you want nothing more than God's healing power to wash over your body, to rid you of this awful disease. And as awful as it is to go through something like cancer, I think what's worse, having never experienced cancer myself, but I think what's worse than going through cancer yourself is watching someone you love and care about go through cancer. Isn't that true? I mean, how many of you would trade places in a heartbeat with someone that you love and care about who is sick like that? And I believe the reason that it's so hard to watch someone you love be sick with cancer is because you're powerless to do anything about it. You want so badly to step in and take care of things, and you can't. One thing I have learned about sickness is that people will try absolutely anything in order to be cured or to feel better. Vitamins, organic food, special diets, home remedies. My grandma on my mom's side, we called her Granny. She was infamous for having Granny's remedies. You know, she always seemed to have a home remedy for something that ailed you. As a matter of fact, and this is a true story, my granny and my poppy, their primary caregiver was a veterinarian. True story. My dad would often say, I don't want to call my mother-in-law a dog, but she does visit a vet. True story as well, Granny and Poppy paid money to go sit in a uranium mine. You know that radioactive material that we tried so hard to stay away? They're paying money so they can go sit in this thing. Here's the thing that I understood from a very young age from them. People will do anything to feel better. And one thing that we see throughout the Old Testament and the New Testament is that God heals those who are physically sick. God heals people physically. We see that very clearly. But God doesn't heal everyone. Why doesn't he? We'll talk about that in just a little bit. Be patient. Well, there's a second type of healing that's out there. It's spiritual healing. And all of us, every single person, is sick with the disease of sin in your life. And there's no really good way to measure how badly or messed up our world is or our lives are. But the Apostle Paul described it pretty well in his letter to the Romans in chapter 8. He said that all of creation is a slave to decay, that this world is wearing out, and it has to do with sin. Paul goes on to say that we know that all of creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth right up to the present time. And guess what? Nearly 2,000 years later, we're still groaning because of our sins. Think about yourself just for a moment. How are you suffering from the effects of sin in your life? Maybe your lying has hurt and damaged the trust that once existed in the relationships you once enjoyed. Maybe your greed and your jealousy of what others have has led you to be discontent or unsatisfied with what you yourself have. Or maybe you have an uncontrolled temper that's caused you to say things that are really, really hurtful that you didn't really intend to say, but ended up hurting people that you care deeply about. Maybe your temper has caused you to lose some jobs, definitely some friendships, and maybe even some family relations. Or maybe your love for gossip has caused you to participate in the assassination of another person's character. And that's caused pain and anguish in the lives of people that you desire to spread their juicy news about. The list goes on and on. I could literally stand up here all day talking about the effects of sin in our lives and how it's messed us up and how it's hurt us. For every sin we commit, there is always a consequence. Always. When we go against God, we bring pain into our lives. It's like James McDonald says, choose to sin, choose to suffer. And I think he's right. And while it is not my intent to stand here and make you feel guilty or ashamed of the bad stuff you've done, it is my intent to remind you that you need spiritually healed, that I need to be spiritually healed. And the good news, the great news, the grace-giving news is that God wants to do that, and he's able to do that. But if you're here today and you've longed to either be healed physically, to be free from some physical ailment, or maybe you're here and you long to be healed spiritually, you've got some addiction in your life that you can't shake, and that healing has not come to you either physically or spiritually, and you're frustrated, maybe this next point is exactly what you need to hear. Second of all, God's healing does not always make sense. If there's one thing we learn about God's healing as we read it in his word, it's this. The way that God chooses to heal doesn't always make a whole lot of sense to us. In fact, if we're just being brutally honest, a lot of the times the way that God heals is just plain weird. Let me give you just a few examples from the Old Testament. In Numbers chapter 21, I want to read a few verses from this chapter, and I need to give you a disclaimer. This story in Numbers chapter 21 is a historical fact. This really happened. But I'm telling you, it's weird, okay? Numbers chapter 21, starting in verse 6. The Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people so that the people of Israel died. So the people came to Moses and said, "We've sinned because we have spoken against the Lord and against you. Intercede with the Lord that he may remove the serpents from us." And Moses interceded for the people. So let me just kind of set the stage for you. You remember Moses and the Israelites. Moses led them out of Egypt. They came to Mount Sinai. They got the Ten Commandments given to them. And they were going to go on to the Promised Land. But because of a disobedience, they were caused to wander in the wilderness for 40 years. They've gone on this journey for 40 years, starting this journey out. And while they're wandering in the wilderness for 40 years, all of a sudden, all these snakes come into the camp, and they start biting people. And why were these snakes brought into the camp? Why did God allow them to come? Because the people were speaking badly about God, and they were speaking badly about Moses. And so this plague of snakes is allowed to come upon the people, and they cry out to Moses, "Moses, tell God to make the snakes stop." I wonder if Moses was ever tempted to not intercede for the people, you know, if he just like had his fill. He's like, nope. I mean, how many of us would be tempted to be like, "Haha, you guys are getting what you deserve," you know? But Moses seems to have a love for these people that runs so deep that he's willing to speak to God on their behalf. And then I want you to notice, and I want you to pay attention to God's solution to this problem of snakes, verses 8 and 9. Do you see it? He says, "Then the Lord said to Moses, 'Make a fiery serpent and set it on a standard. And it shall come about that everyone who is bitten, when he looks at it, he's going to live.' And so Moses made a bronze serpent and he set it on a pole. And it came about that if a serpent bit any man, that when he looked at the bronze serpent, that man lived." Is that weird to anybody else? I mean, here God's like, "Hey, go make a bronze snake, put it on a pole, let people look at it. And when they do, they're going to be healed." That seems very strange to me, doesn't it? Got a couple questions for you. Does anybody recognize this symbol? This is a universal symbol for medicine. And if you pay really close attention, those things that are winding around that bronze pole are really two serpents. This symbol is called the caduceus symbol. It's used as a modern symbol for medicine, for healing. There's also another symbol that is used by clinics and medical organizations. It's called the Asclepius. And the origins of these two symbols are credited to Greek mythology, okay? But can anybody else guess where this symbol might have gotten its significance? A snake pole that brings healing. What a strange way that God chose to bring healing to the people of Israel. Another strange healing that the Old Testament records is found in Exodus chapter 15. Let me just read some of these verses for you. And again, it's weird. It doesn't make sense. Exodus chapter 15. Then Moses led Israel from the Red Sea, and they went out into the wilderness of Shur. And they went 3 days in the wilderness and found no water. When they came to Marah, they could not drink the waters of Marah, for they were bitter. Therefore, they called that place Marah. So the people grumbled at Moses, saying, "What shall we drink?" Now, I can totally kind of relate to this story on a personal level. If you know me, then you know that I like to go hiking from time to time. And one of the things that we did 2 summers ago was I went hiking with my buddy Paul Shriver on the Ozark Trail in southern Missouri. It was July, and the temperature was like 43 million degrees or something. It was hot, and the humidity was like 100%, and we were hiking the Ozark Trail. And if you've ever hiked the Ozark Trail, it's not an easy trail. It's actually pretty difficult. And on top of that, we were camping on the trail, and we had all of our gear with us. And so we were hiking the Ozark Trail with about 60 pounds of gear. This was taken like at our lowest moment, okay? And I was debating on whether to share this with you this morning, but I thought, we're family. I'll show it to you. Let's see this video.
Well, here we are. How many miles have we traveled, Paul?
16.
16 miles.
Ish. I'm over here. There you go. It's been a long haul. We're tired. We're ready to be there, but we're not.
Look at the sweat. This is the sweatiest, hottest I've been. I'm down to drinking river water.
Are you serious?
I'm serious about that. But it's been purified with my Sawyer, so we should be good to go. It's about 12:38, and we have about, I would guess, 4.5 miles left to go. So, that'll be fun. All right, bye. Got anything to say, Paul?
Nope. Hope Honker makes it.
Makes two of us.
We made it. In case you're curious, in case you were wanting to know, we did make it. And I was totally serious. We ran out of water. Like, we had our backpacks filled with water. We had extra water, but we were going through it so quickly. And we ran out of water. So our main water source was there was this little creek that we found. It wasn't a river. It was a creek. But and I used this water purifier. And you fill this bag up with creek water. You screw this on top of it. And then you squeeze the water out of this into a container. And then you drink it. Now, it purified it. It made it safe to drink. But you know what? That water was disgusting because it still tasted like fish water, okay? And so even though we needed to drink water, even though that was what we're supposed to do, we didn't feel like drinking water because it was disgusting. And so I can kind of somewhat relate to the Israelites grumbling in Exodus chapter 15. And what shall we drink? That's what they were wondering. Well, look at, if you will, how God heals the waters. And verse 25, it's strange what he says to do. Verse 25, it says, "Then Moses cried out to the Lord, and the Lord showed him a tree, and he threw it into the waters, and the waters became sweet." Maybe we should have tried that, right? I don't know, but throw a stick in the water and it becomes good to drink? Strange. One more story. We don't have a lot of time, but I'm going to quickly touch on this one too. It's the story of Naaman. His story is a cool story. We don't have time to read it all, but he was a respected general of his army. But one thing that Naaman was suffering with, if you know his story, he had leprosy. And during one of his military campaigns, he captures a little Israelite girl and makes her the servant of his wife. And throughout the course, as they're kind of, you know, doing life together, this little girl happens to say to Naaman, "You know what? It's too bad you've got leprosy. Too bad you need to go see Elisha, because he could heal you. He could cure you. I've seen him do some amazing things." And so Naaman gets it in his mind that he's going to go see Elisha. And he goes with his chariot army, and Elisha tells him what God would have him to do to be healed. 2 Kings chapter 5, starting in verse 10. Elisha sent a messenger to him, saying, "Go and wash in the Jordan 7 times, and your flesh will be restored to you, and you will be clean." But Naaman was furious, and he went away, and he said, "Behold, I thought he will surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, wave his hand over the place, and cure me." Are not the rivers where I'm used to going in Damascus, aren't they better than all these waters here in Israel? Couldn't I have washed back home and be cleaned? So Naaman turned away and he went away in a rage. But Naaman's servants came to him and said, "My father, had the prophet told you to do some great thing, would you not have done it? How much more then when he says to you, 'Wash and be clean'?" And so Naaman went down and he dipped himself 7 times in the Jordan according to the word of the man of God, and his flesh was restored like the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. You understand, don't you, that the point of all these stories found in Scripture is that God's healing doesn't always make sense to us. Naaman was pretty upset at what God was telling him to do to be healed. And isn't that the truth? A lot of times, God's healing does not make sense to us. For instance, why does God choose to heal certain people and not others? Well, I can't tell you who God will physically heal and who he will not. But in all these situations, we have to ask this question. Why all the weird methods? Why didn't God just heal the snake-bitten people without having them look at a bronze snake on a pole? Why didn't God just snap his fingers and heal the waters without throwing some wood into them to make them sweet? Why didn't God just heal Naaman without him having to go wash in the Jordan 7 times? I don't know for sure, but this is what I do know. God demands faith. He wants you to believe in him. And how is faith demonstrated? Faith is demonstrated through obedience, through action. It's not enough to simply say, "I believe in you, God." You have to do what he tells you to do. Even if it doesn't make sense, even if it sounds crazy, you've got to do what he tells you to do. And so many people don't want to turn to modern day medicine. They want a healing from God. Well, could it be that God is choosing to heal you through modern day medicine? And if you're obedient to do and use the modern day medicine, God will show you his healing. God asks some pretty crazy things from people. And I believe he does so because he wants us to show our faith, to demonstrate our faith. Healing is necessary. Healing doesn't always make sense to us. Here's where we need to end our study today, and it's the most important point of the day. Jesus is the ultimate healer. God revealed as healer has never been more clearly seen than through the coming of Jesus Christ, his son. Jesus was 30 years old when he began his earthly ministry. It was relatively a short ministry, only 3 years long. But in those 3 years, Jesus accomplished a lot. First of all, he healed people physically. I found this interesting. Nearly 20% of the gospel writings spend time recording the healings performed by Jesus. There are 31 individual healings that Jesus performed according to the 4 Gospels. We can read of him healing time and time again different people with different illnesses and sicknesses. We can read of him healing blind people. Now, I want to do a little exercise here this morning to help you understand and appreciate this type of healing. Would everybody just please close your eyes just for a second? Keep them closed. Now just turn your head to the right and turn your head to the left. Look up, look down. Imagine this is your lot in life, darkness. And then Jesus shows up and he says, "Open your eyes, and you can see." We hear about Jesus healing lame people, leprous people, dead people. He heals people physically. But Jesus not only healed people physically, he healed people, and more importantly, spiritually. I think all of us have an understanding as to why Jesus came to this earth. He came to this earth so that he could die on a cross on Calvary, so that he could be the perfect sacrifice for our sins. I mean, that's what Isaiah chapter 53, verses 5 and 6 are about. It was a prophecy. It was predicting that Jesus would one day come and heal people spiritually. Listen to these verses. "But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. All of us, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, but the Lord has laid upon him the iniquity of us all." What are the stripes by which we are healed? It was the beating that Jesus took before he died on the cross, the blood that was poured out. That's how we're healed, and it heals us spiritually. But even before Jesus faced Calvary, he was passionate about healing people spiritually. Luke chapter 5 is probably one of my favorite stories of healing in the New Testament. I want to read it, and then I'm going to make a couple of observations about it. Luke chapter 5, starting in verse 18. And some men were carrying on a bed a man who was paralyzed. And they were trying to bring their friend in and set him down before Jesus. But not finding any way to bring him in because of the crowd, they went up on top of the roof and they let him down through the tiles with his stretcher into the middle of the crowd in front of Jesus. And seeing their faith, Jesus said, "Friend, your sins are forgiven you." The reason I like this story so much, I think, is because you can, first of all, see how passionate this man's friends were. They loved him, they cared for him, so much so that they were trying to get him to Jesus, and they weren't going to let anything stop them. They literally went above and beyond. And so they lower their friend through the roof, and they put him at the feet of Jesus, and Jesus sees the man, and he says, "Your sins are forgiven." That's great in all, Jesus, but we're here so you can help him walk again. We've heard how you've healed blind people. We've heard how you've healed lepers. We're here to heal his legs so he can walk. Well, that brings up a really good question. Why did Jesus address the man's sin in his life first? If you continue reading in Luke 18, Jesus eventually gets to the healing of the man's legs and he's able to walk. But why did Jesus start with the sin issue first? I mean, why doesn't God heal everybody physically all the time when we want it and how we want it? I've sat earnestly with people and I've cried with people who were sick, and we prayed earnestly, I mean sincerely, praying and believing that God would intervene, that he would save their life. And you know what? He didn't. They still ended up dying. The cancer was never gone. Why does God choose not to heal those people? I don't know. But I do know this. Isn't it true that if God healed every person that we cared about who got even a case of the sniffles or even some serious disease, that heaven would be pretty empty, would it not? If God answered every prayer of healing that we had, that, "God, please don't let my grandpa get sick. Please don't let him die," there would never be anybody in heaven. But another reason that I believe God doesn't always heal everyone all the time, listen, and this is really important, jot it down someplace. More than healing your body, more than healing you physically, Jesus is interested in healing your soul. That's what he cares about first and foremost. Your soul is God's number one priority. And so the next time you're frustrated at the fact that God hasn't healed your loved one the way that you want them to, the reason that God doesn't cure every physical ailment is because he cares more about your spiritual healing than he does your physical healing. Now, don't misunderstand me. Don't confuse what I've just said here this morning. God cares that you are suffering with a sickness that you have. He cares very deeply about the pain that you're experiencing. So don't misunderstand me and say, "Well, God doesn't care about my physical well-being." That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is God cares more about your spiritual well-being than he does your physical. How do I know? Remember the story of Lazarus in John chapter 11? Lazarus was one of Jesus' best friends. And while Jesus was out doing ministry, he receives word that his best friend Lazarus is sick and that he's really sick. And instead of rushing there to be by Lazarus' side, Jesus stays where he's at for a few more days. And when Jesus finally does show up to see Lazarus, it's discovered that Lazarus has died. And the sisters of Lazarus are pretty ticked off at Jesus for not coming sooner. And in the midst of conversation, Jesus requests to see the tomb where they laid Lazarus. And when he goes there and he sees the tomb, John chapter 11, verse 35 is the shortest verse in the Bible, but it's also one of the most important verses in the Bible. It's just two words. Do you know what they are? Jesus wept. So don't confuse or don't believe for a second that God does not care about your sickness, that God does not care about the ailment that you're suffering with. God very much so cares. But even more urgent to God than your physical well-being, because that's number two on God's priority list, even more dear and near to his heart is your physical well-being. is your spiritual well-being. I mean, even in the story of when Jesus was raising Lazarus back to life, yes, Lazarus was raised back to life. He was healed physically, completely. But listen, even Lazarus had to experience a second funeral. God wants to heal what will last an eternity. And so he's concerned about the soul. We're going to move right now into our time decision here this morning. And it's my hope for you this morning that you see very clearly that God is Jehovah Rapha, that he's the God who heals. This morning for our decision time, I want to play a song that captures and expresses and conveys what I've been trying so hard to do this morning. And it sums it up perfectly. God is a God who heals. And more than healing the physical, what God cares about is the spiritual. And if you're fortunate, if you're blessed, God heals both. But understand that if you're going through a physical ailment right now and you're frustrated with that, God cares about the soul. He cares about the spirit. We're going to have our song of decision, and what I wanted to do is just remain seated while this is being played. But if you have a decision that needs to be made, maybe you are here this morning, you're facing some physical ailment that you need prayer for. You know, James tells us that if any of you are sick, you go get the elders and to pray for you and to anoint you with oil. We have elders, we have staff who would be more than happy to pray for you and with you. But maybe you're here this morning and you have a physical or a spiritual ailment that's not been dealt with. You need some healing in your spiritual life. Well, remember what Jesus Christ did for you on the cross, and then remember that you are flawless. And if you need to talk about that spiritual ailment, we are available as well. Let's turn the lights off, and let's watch this video. And if you have a decision that needs to be made, would you please come forward and sit next to me right here in this front.
There's got to be more than going back and forth. Taught that's who we are. Well, come on, get in line right behind me. You along with everybody, thinking there's worth in what you do. Then like a hero who takes the stage, when we're on the edge of our seat, saying it's too late. Well, let me introduce you to amazing grace. No matter the bumps, no matter the bruises, no matter the scars, still the truth is the cross has made, the cross has made you flawless. The cross has made you flawless. No matter the hurt or how deep the wound is, no matter the pain, still the truth. Can't believe that this unconditional kind of love would be enough to take a filthy wretch like this and wrap him up in righteousness. But that's exactly what he did. No matter the bumps, no matter the bruises, no matter the scars, still the truth is the cross has made, the cross has made. Introduce you to grace, grace, God's grace.